Okay, thank you very much. And let me start with saying a huge thank you to the organizers for inviting me here to this exciting event at a very outstanding place. So I will return home with many valuable impressions from a country which I've never visited before. So thanks for having me here. Yeah, so secondly, I apologize, as others already did, there will be no perfectoid spaces in my talk. However, I will report on a theorem which basically assigns functorially Galois representations to certain Hecken modules. I will be most explaining the content of the theorem and not really describing how this is achieved and proven. But the way how it is actually achieved is relying entirely on the theory of phi gamma modules. And phi gamma modules are in close relations to things we have seen with respect to the Fark-Fontaine curve, as Kiran explained to us yesterday. And also, I think that the next talk will actually be devoted to phi gamma modules. So this, in that sense, these are very, very close to each other. Okay, so let me start with motivations. So F or QP will be a finite field extension. Q will be the cardinality of the residue field. And script G will be the absolute Galois group of F. Yes, okay. Then I fix throughout G over OF, a reductive group, split reductive group. And split reductive groups can be classified by certain root data, and by dualizing these root data, one gets another reductive group, which I denote by G, check the dual reductive group. So these split reductive groups come, so to speak, in pairs, each one with its dual. For example, if G happens to be GLN, then the dual will again be a GLN. If G happens to be SLN, then the dual will be PGL. And I can give you more examples of classical pairs of classical groups, which are in that sense dual to each other. Okay, and then that throughout this talk, little k be another field. For the moment, completely unrelated to F, but soon I'm going to make a more specific assumption on it. So the thing I want to talk about is motivated by the local Langlands philosophy. Let me be very rough in explaining what its main intention is. The Langlands philosophy predicts that there should be some sort of correspondence perhaps even bijection. But this is in general asking for too much between, on the one hand, representations of the Galois group of F into the dual group, and to the K points of the dual group of G, on my notation, what's meant to be this, this. And on the other hand, this should somehow correspond to, and now I'm really vague, certain possibly you want them to be irreducible, smooth, and you may want to put an immiscibility condition. Representations of G of F on K vector spaces of G, so this will be G underlined of F on K vector spaces. Here, this is meant to be the dual. Thank you. Yes. Yes, so for example, if you take as your pair a pair of two GLNs, then you want to relate n-dimensional Galois representations with representations of the GLN of F on k-vector spaces. So this one is a dual of this one. And yeah, this is of course very coarse, and I'm not going to say basically, I'm going to say nothing about this precisely, and yeah, I should say nice answers to this objective have been given in the case where little k is, say, the field of complex numbers, or more generally, field of characteristic zero, algebraically closed, and there are also good answers given in the case where the characteristic of little k is prime to p, but in today's talk, I want to focus on the case where k, little k, has actually characteristic p, this p, and in that case we are really almost completely in the blue still, so that is in a sense the most interesting one for us. So here, characteristic of little k will always be assumed to be p, and I'm going to make a more specific assumption very soon. Yeah, so in that case, we have problems with asking for some sort of bijection. In that case, we actually know that beyond the case where F is QP and G is GL2, we know that the set B is actually much, much too large. So that, and I mean, A can be well controlled, but B is much large, so there's never hope to have anything like a bijection. And yeah, but this does not concern the case of GL2QP, but the case of GL2QP, which is basically settled by work of Colmes and Breuil and others, that showed up actually a new feature, namely that there's actually a functorial relation between A and B. And my proposal, the thing which I want to talk about is actually replace B by something else, which is smaller and has a chance to be in bijection with A, or something close to a bijection, and actually to realize then some sort of bijection by even a functor. So this will be the aim of today's talk. Aim, instead of B, consider B prime, the super singular modules, so irreducible modules over the algebra of G, over the 4P. Ivahori Hecke algebra of G, and then the outcome will be reasonable maps. It's a question what is reasonable, but I'm not going to say more about this. So B prime to A do exist and can actually be upgraded into exact functors and can be upgraded into exact func tests. Between abelian categories. Perhaps I delete these brackets here. I really mean that. Okay. I did not yet explain what are reducible supersingular modules about the Hecker algebra. I'm going to do that. That at least, but if you just take these terms, then you may imagine that this is actually an abelian category. Whereas this clearly is not an abelian category. This is just a set of maps. But you can imagine that this sits in some category of Galois representations, and this will be the surrounding abelian category in which my functors are going to take values. Yes, I'm going to say a little about this when we come to that. So some more pieces of notations. T underlined check, so that's an underlined in G underlined check, and T underlined in G underlined be compatible in maximal tori, compatible F split maximal tori. Then standard notation, I think x upper star of t perhaps I should write an underline, but I'm going to just write it like this. This is the Horn t underlined to the multiplicative group, and this is dual to the x lower star of t, which is the Horn of the multiplicative group into t. Or if you want the Horn of the T line check to GM. Okay, so that is the sum. So then let me first talk about these A's which I want to discuss. So paragraph 2, standard homomorphisms. From the absolute Galois group to the G-check of K. So I'm going to single out certain of these homomorphisms which will be relevant for our constructions. So I fix C dot in the normalizer of the k points of g-check in the k points of g-check, mapping to a Coxeter element in the finite by group. It's called C in the finite by group, which is a quotient n g-check of t of k by t check of k. And I could also just delete the checks and still talk about the same group. So that is a finite by group associated to g and t check. So the Coxeter element is, a Coxeter element is given by any product in any order of a set of Coxeter generators of that finite by group. If you don't know what this is, that's not really important. In a sense, you could just actually think of just deleting this condition, and everything which I'm going to say is still true. So in a sense, it's not really important. And now I make an additional assumption on little k. So we assume that K contains K contains F q to the h, fq to the h, where h is the order of the Coxeter element, or in other words, the Coxeter number of g, or g check. I mean, if you don't know what that means, that is not really important. That is not really important. And now, like in the previous talk, we will have to consider I and G, the inertia subgroup. And in addition, we fix, let's write me this way, F in G, a Frobenius element. So lift the Q power Frobenius on the residue field. On the residue field. So in other words, then this G is generated by inertia together with this element F in a very transparent way. So I say topologically generated. Okay, then let me define what a standard homomorphism is. So this is with respect to this chosen C dot, a C dot standard homomorphism rho of our Hatzfeld-Galois group into the G check of K is a continuous homomorphism which takes this Frobenius element to C dot. So C dot is an element in here, in particular in this group, and which sends the inertia subgroup into our dual torus. Yes. So that is what I refer to as standard homomorphisms. And just to explain that this is not very a bizarre condition or very strange one, namely in the case where G happens to be GLN, I in this way capture all the irreducible h-dimensional representations. So if G happens to be, and then of the G-check, GL, okay, now I need to write H because H is our Coxeter number, if that is the case, then every reducible H-dimensional Galois representation over little k always is given by a C dot standard homomorphism. So that is a very generic notion in a sense. However, from now on, for simplicity of exposition, I'm going to restrict to the case where G is semi-simple and simply connected. So this basically excludes the GLN case, but this is really just for simplifying the statements which I want to make. You can handle the more general case, but this would require too much notation. So from now on, G is assumed to be simply connected. For simplicity. For simplicity EGSLH. So my first statement, which I want to make now, is that one can, in a sense, parameterize these standard homomorphisms in a very economic and transparent way. As follows. So this parameterization will depend on the choice of a certain element eta in our character group of T, on which I assume, on which I make the assumption, such that its image element in X, the character group, let me write this where Q minus 1, Q minus sub Q minus 1, this is a character group reduced mod Q minus 1, so that the finite finite degenerate abelian group reduces mod Q minus 1. So such that the image in here is lies in the image of a C minus identity acting on X sub star of T. So recall C is an element in the Coxeter group N of T mod T. So it's going to act on T. And in this way, it's going to act on the characters of T and C minus identity is then acting on here. So Q minus one. Yes. And I asked that the image element, this element eta maps to an element in here lying in the image of this endomorphism. This is a condition which I impose on eta. Then we have the following. There is some eta check or eta head, it's in my notation, in the characters which are fixed under the identity. So this means fixed space under C. So C is the identity on it, such that the element mu defined as sum AI from 0 to H minus 1. We call H is this Coxeter number, Q to the I C to the minus I eta minus epsilon hat. So this happens inside this free finitely generated group X upper star T. That I define this new element mu. So this element can be made by a suitable choice of epsilon hat divisible by Q minus 1. So in X upper star of T, which is, recall this, this is at the same time the X lower star of T check. And now the composition inertia to F Q to the H. So I go from the inertia to F Q to the H. So it's units, so by the omega H minus omega H. So the omega 2 we have seen in the previous talk, this is nothing but the fundamental character of level H, or if you want the inverse of the itinerary reciprocity map for the unramified extension of F with this relative field. So the composition here, and now I write That's correct. But let me now write this as Gm of f q to the h, so that now it makes sense to apply 1 over q minus 1 mu to this. And this takes us then into the t-check of k, that's fine. So if you want, first of all, to the f q to the h, and then in particular to the t-check of k. So this defines a standard homomorphism, right? A standard homomorphism. Rho mu, depending only on mu. So recall, the standard homomorphism is defined like this. For standard homomorphism, I already require that f goes to the c dot. That is already, so to speak, fixed. And since g is generated by I and this element, I only needed to say what it does on the inertia, and this is what I wanted to do on inertia. Okay, so in this way we can produce such standard homomorphisms from such elements, this should be an eta, depending on an eta. I mean, that was trivial, of course. The interesting thing is it depends only on eta, and moreover, any standard homomorphism is hit in this way. Moreover, each standard homomorphism arises in this way. Okay, so that is the first result from which I want to start out. The way to parameterize these standard homomorphisms by these elements eta. But now, as I indicated, my point will be to define this category now, this set, or even, meaning category B prime of supersingular modules and assign to the reducible ones standard homomorphism by assigning to the irreducible ones such etas, and then to upgrade this actually into an exact functor. Okay, paragraph 3, super singular. Hecker modules. So I choose once and for all a maximal Pro-P subgroup in G. Pro-P subgroup I in G. So G, recall, is G, the F points of our reductive group G. I wanted to fix a standard, an apartment stable under fixing a chamber in the apartment stable under T. For example, if G happens to be GLN, or say SLN, that is what we included, then you can take I to be, and the maximal torus is the diagonal matrices, then you can take I to be the matrices with entries in OF, which mod P reduced to an upper triangular matrix. Okay, and then the important definition is this, the Pro-P Ivor-Horiak algebra, Pro-P Ivor-Horiak algebra, H is the endomorphism algebra of, so as a G representation of the representation in the trivial representations from I induced up to G. So 1K, so to speak, means the one dimensional trivial representation of I. This induced up to G. So this is a G representation, and I take its endomorphism algebra. And in fact, I want it want actually the opposite algebra for convenience. So explicitly, so to speak, as a vector space, this can be realized as a double coset algebra of for the double cosets of I and G, with multiplication given by a convolution product. And my point is, so to speak, the Hecker modules somehow approximate, in a sense, the G representations. I come to this in a moment again, where I can make this slightly more precise. But let me first state the following fact. So one can start a module theory over this category, and when doing this, one detects a certain subcategory inside the category of all the modules of H, which is a category of super singular modules. Let me gather this in the following statement. There is an abelian subcategory mod SSH of so-called super singular finite dimensional H modules so I give you two important properties. Stable under under extensions and subquotients, and they detect, so to speak, super cuspidality in the following sense, an irreducible admissible G representation V is supercuspidal if and only if VI is a super singular Hecker module. Yeah, now in which sense is VI in Hecker module? I need to perhaps briefly explain this. So VI is the invariance of V under the group I, so the elements fixed by I. So you can identify this with Hom I invariant Homs from K to V, and this by Frobenius reciprocity. You can identify with G homomorphism from the induced representation, which I use to define H to V, and then you see that you indeed have an action by H, and this makes VI into an H module. And I should say this is not the definition of supersingularity. However, it is the theorem, the official definition of supersingularity I'm not going to give you, but it's a theorem of Marie-France Villeneuve and Rachel Olivier that this is basically, that this is true, and this is all what one perhaps would want to need about supersingular modules in the first approximation. I would think that it is true. But I think what I wrote here is true. What I wrote here is true. I mean, I'm saying that this category has these properties. I think that is true. I mean, stating these properties, I think, should be. I'm not saying that this is a definition. I'm not saying this. So, but the outcome, so to speak, is that super singular modules kind of detect supercuspidality make up an important abelian subcategory. And in fact, there's a notion of parabolic induction for even for Hecke modules. And in a sense, you can say that all Hecke modules are built up from supersingular ones by some process of parabolic induction. So these are, in a sense, the key objects which one needs to understand when one wants to understand H modules. Some more facts. So first let E be the set of isomorphism classes of reducible supersingulars. Objects in mod SS. Then we have the following facts. These are actually one-dimensional. For each M and E. And then the other, this is once more Marie-France Binaras. She tells us a lot about the structure of, I mean, basically everything about the structure of H, which we would want to know. In particular, she tells us that the K-algebra H is generated by, firstly, the elements TT. These are the double cosets ITI for T in T underlined of mu q minus 1, where q minus 1 denotes q minus first roots of unity. So this sits inside a multiplicative group. It makes sense to talk about these elements. And secondly, by the elements TS, double coset ISI for S in a set of Coxeter generators for the affine Weyl group. So where S in N GT maps bijectively to a set of Coxeter generators of the affine Weyl group in this game. Which you may want to define as NG of T by a T of OF. I perhaps instead of T, I should have written T underlined of F. And here's where T underlined. That should be okay. Mu q minus 1 is the group of q minus first roots of unity. This is the. But inside this, you have the q minus 1 mapping to F star to of the residue field. A and B is actually both statements. This statement and this statement is both hold true only under the assumption which I made on G. So, therefore, an element in our set E is determined by firstly the character with which the maximal torus acts via these hack operators TT, which I wrote down here. So this is in here. So this is then isomorphic with a HOM T underlined of Q mu Q minus 1 determined by the action of the TTs acting on M. And in addition, you have to specify the action of these TSs, so the eigenvalues of the TS acting on M. And here it's actually, you have not huge choice. It turns out that these eigenvalues can be only 0 or minus 1. So these belong to 0, minus 1. There are no more choices. Okay, so this is what I want to say about the supersingular Hecke modules. And now my next paragraph I call enigmata and defuncta. And defuncta. Definition. An enigma is a map of sets eta from our set E of irreducible super singular Hecke modules to x upper star t such that if you compose it with the reduction mod q minus 1, so e via eta to x upper star t reduced mod q minus 1. This is given by sending an irreducible Hecke module to the character epsilon of M, which I assign to M here. It's given by, not exactly that character, but by the following, the C minus 1, the C inverse of that character minus that character. Yes, it's the inverse of that character minus that character. So you see, you recognize the condition which I gave in the second paragraph. Elements in the image of this map will satisfy this additional assumption which I imposed on the eta in the second paragraph. So therefore, by theorem one, an enigma induces a map eta tilde from our set E to the set of standard homomorphisms color group to G check of K, namely by taking M to eta tilde of M, which by definition is the rho eta of M in the sense I defined it in the second paragraph. Okay, so in a sense, this is my approximation to the searched for map from B prime to A. But at this talk, at this point, of course, at this point, it may not yet be clear why this particular choice of a map from Packer models to Galois representation should be very useful or good. And I want to justify this particular construction by saying that this construction can be upgraded into a functor between abelian categories. That is, so to speak, the point of this construction. So the construction or the assignment will always depend on the choice of such an enigma. So theorem two. Fix an enigma eta and a rational representation of the dual group of G check over K. So that's a finite dimensional representation, in particular of algebraic representation of D check over K. Finite dimensional over K. So then there is an exact functor. That is an important point, exactness factor, functor W from our category of super singular Hecke modules. Yeah, now I come back to the point which I mentioned earlier. The set of standard homomorphisms, of all homomorphisms in the dual group, clearly does not make an abelian category. It's just a map, it's just a set. And to make this into a category, one would naturally look to the category of all Galois representations. Yeah, let's do that. Such that if M happens to be irreducible, then this WM is a W of M is nothing but the thing we assigned here, namely then WM is given by G, now take this eta tilde n I've been talking about here, to the G check of K, and then V being a G check representation has a map from G check of K to V, to GLV. Yeah, so in this sense, this assignment here is lifted up into an exact functor. And exactness is, of course, here somehow the point, right? Now takes care of arbitrary extensions between these elements in E and still produces, still produces larger Galois representations, which, on the reducible ones, spit out our morphisms into a G check of K. I should perhaps say this V, which is in the game here, only plays an auxiliary role. This is not really important. I mean, you could take So ideally, you would take you could take a faithful representation of G check, but that is anyway not really important. So B only plays an auxiliary role, but you have to make such such a choice since morphisms from G to G check K, otherwise it's not easy to see how in any other sense you could make them into an Abelian category. And I should also say this construction of this functor is actually functorial in V, so you may want to work with all the Vs at the same time. That is perhaps the most cleanest way to think of this. So V is functorial in W is functorial in V, and as I say, you may perhaps better rephrase this all this in terms of being a functor on super singular Hecker modules times the rational representation of the dual group. Okay, so in this sense, I can upgrade my assignment here into a functor. But still, that already looks good. Since I have some more time, I can explain a little bit more. It's about 8 minutes, yeah. You can still ask, now it can be even more ambitious. Can one ask, what is lost of the extension structures between various elements in E when we apply this functor W? One could ask, is this functor perhaps even something like close to being fully faithful. That is not true on the nose. However, one can approximate fully faithfulness even quite closely. This is what I want to explain the remaining minutes. Although I have to be rough and kind of cheat a little bit in order to have a theorem which I can write down within such a short time. So roughly the claim is W can almost be upgraded into a fully faithful functor. So at least if B is fully faithful. So let me explain this very roughly. So I need to pass to a slightly larger category than that of Galois representations. I need to also, so to speak, one more piece of conditional structure as follows. So let me write rep K G, and now I write an upper V. So this is a name for this rational representation. This is a category of pairs. W alpha, so where W is a Galois representation, as before. And alpha is a K-linear isomorphism. No group structures involved, only K-linear isomorphism between M tensor V and W for some M depending on the pair. So it's, if you want, it's a tensor division of W. So you can tensor divide W by V, and this is an additional structure which I want to impose here. And then a theorem 2 prime, W can be lifted to functor to this larger category or to this kind of covering category, or however you want to refer to this, W tilde from mod SS H to this rep KV of G. And actually, yeah, since this is probably recorded on video, I should add right away, I'm a little bit cheating here. This is not entirely true what I can prove. I can prove something which is really looks like this, and this might be true. However, there's a detail which I cannot really fit in at this point, but morally it is like this. It is like this morally at least. So I'm slightly cheating, but it may be actually true in this way, but there's an epsilon which I cannot prove at this moment. Yeah, and moreover, this is the point, moreover, for good choices of eta, so everything here once more depends on the choice of eta, for good choices of eta, and I know that they do exist. And they're, in a sense, they are also natural ones. And slight shrinkings of my category of supersingulars and slight shrinkings of, I am denoting them. Mod E prime of H of mod SSH, where actually often in many cases I can actually take them to be the same. So often they are the same. So often mod E prime H is all supersingulars, and at other occasions I need to throw away a little bit of mod SS, and if I then restrict this functor to this slight shrinking, it becomes surjective, fully faithful. Let me write this down and then I'll stop. The restriction, comma, the restriction of W tilde to this mod E prime of H is fully faithful. So in particular, take full extension structures which you encounter in this category into full account. Okay, that's a good point now to stop here.